Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. We want to welcome you to the Think on These Things live stream sermon session sponsored by the Total Life Church on this beautiful Sunday morning. And hopefully all of us are, have had a wonderful night's sleep, and we're ready for a quick word this morning to just be a blessing to ourselves. And so we do want to welcome our church members, our family members, and our friends, and those folks who may just stop in during the week to catch a quick word. We hope and pray that all that we share and discuss today would be a blessing for you. So we do want to encourage you to sit back and maybe perhaps get some tea or some coffee or some toast or something where that you can just drink and chew on as we share in God's word this morning. And before we share in God's word, we do want to remind those of us who are members of the Total Life Church that the fifth Sunday of this month, which is November 29th, is going to be Maximize Giving Sunday. So we just want to remind you of that before we start. The fifth Sunday in this month, November 29th, is going to be Maximize Giving Sunday. So we are hoping that you will remember that and start budgeting out for that special event, and because that is a special Capital Stewardship Sunday for us here at Total Life Church. So hopefully that will be a blessing to you. Amen. There is a word from the Lord, and we are going to share it. It's found in the book of Proverbs, chapter 30, the book of Proverbs, chapter number 30, verses 24 and 27. The book of Proverbs, chapter 30, verses 24 and 27. And there you'll find these interesting words recorded. We're reading from the NIV version this morning, Proverbs 30, 24 and 27. And there you'll find these words recorded. Four things on the earth are small, yet they are extremely wise. Verse 27, locusts have no king, yet they advance together in ranks. Again, verse 27, locusts have no king, yet they advance together in ranks. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer, shall we? Lord, we thank you and we praise you for this, another great and glorious opportunity you have given us as believers to share in your word this morning. And we pray, God, that as we dig into the coffers of your word this morning, we pray that you'd open our eyes that we might see, open our ears that we might hear, soften the soil of our hearts that we might be receptive to the seeds that you desire to plant within them. And furthermore, Lord, help us not just to be hearers of your word, but to be doers as well. Grant that the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts would be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. For the last few weeks, we've been talking about great things that are small. In the first week, we talked about lessons from a spider. And we dug into what God's word has to say about spiders. And the following week, we talked about lessons from an ant. And we looked at what God's word has to say about what we can glean from ants. And today I'd like to talk to you from the subject, lessons from the locusts. Lessons from the locusts. I want to talk to you today from the subject, lessons from the locusts. Lessons from the locusts. The first time we see them mentioned in scripture is when they're unleashed by God as the eighth plague in a 10-plague onslaught upon the Egyptian pharaoh and the Egyptians. You remember this plague. In an attempt to get Pharaoh to release the Jews, God sent a large swarm of them, so huge that they eclipsed the sky. And not only that, they were so numerous that they literally covered every nook and cranny of the Egyptian ground. The ground was covered by them until they were, in fact, pitch black. And the sky was covered by them until the sun could no longer be seen. They devoured practically everything in their paths, fields and vegetation, agriculture and fruit and trees. They totally decimated Egypt. I mean, they shut it down so much to the point where Pharaoh begged Moses, begged him to pray to God, to ask God to take the plague away. That's how formidable these locusts were. And this text speaks to us today about these same ravenous, voracious creatures known as locusts. You see, in an effort to expose his audience to the wisdom and the grandeur of some of God's smallest yet wisest creatures, Solomon in our text for today highlights the locusts. And he does so because in them, he sees several impressive characteristics that he feels that we could all learn from, one of which he clearly underscores in our text for today, in the second half of verse 27. Watch what he writes. He writes, yet they advance together in ranks. The King James Version puts it like this, yet go they forth, all of them, by bands. In other words, Solomon is saying that locusts are team players, that they understand and harness the power of teamwork. Locusts work together in large numbers. They work together as a unit. They collaborate as one big army. And how true this is, because research indicates that locusts innately have a pack mentality, that when the environmental conditions are just right, particularly after a drought, particularly after lots of rain, when green vegetation has sprouted up, locusts will enter a city in swarms. They will enter a city in a mass pack, in a large community. In fact, research indicates that a swarm of locusts can span 460 square miles in size, with anywhere from 40 to 80 million locusts packed into less than half a square mile. That's how collaborative they are. This is why when the Bible depicts locusts in its stories, we're told of a blackened sky and an eclipsed sun and a ground that's completely covered. So locusts are collaborative creatures who value working in large groups. They believe in teamwork. They believe in community. They are one of nature's most collaborative creatures. You see, and that brings us to lesson number one. Listen, the first lesson locusts teach us is that we ought to be collaborative people. The first lesson locusts teach us is that we ought to be collaborative people. The first lesson locusts teach us is that we ought to be collaborative people. In other words, we as believers, like locusts, need to work together. You see, in African epistemology, in African epistemology, there exists a collective mindset that essentially says, I am because we are. In other words, there was a collective sense of unity and oneness amongst people. When people did things, they did them as a group, even if only one person did it. They did it as a collective consciousness. So if one person won, all the community won. If one person accomplished something great, the whole community accomplished something great. If one young person went off to school, the whole community rejoiced in him going after school. If one person wept, they all wept. If one person rejoiced, they all rejoiced. There was an inherent sense of oneness that existed in their communities. It's what Paul was talking about in Romans 12:15 when he says, rejoice with them that do rejoice and weep with them that weep. But for some reason, not here in the U.S. No, not here in the U.S. You see, the zeitgeist of our westernized culture is one of a self-oriented mentality of individualistic existence. Are you with me? In other words, we're all lone rangers now. We're all flying solo. We're all phobo, for ourselves, by ourselves. Now, instead of our mindset being I am because we are, it is I am because I am. And this is the prevailing mentality of most of us in the modern day West. But these locusts remind us that if we want to accomplish anything worthwhile in life, we have to find a way to do it together. Because the possibility for success is much greater in numbers. It's what the 17th century British writer John Donne was talking about when he said, no man is an island entire of itself. Those of you who love basketball, you'll remember this. Back in the 1999 NBA semifinals, the San Antonio Spurs displayed the collaborative wisdom of locusts perfectly. They destroyed the LA Lakers like a plague, according to the commentators, not because they had better players, but because they played like a unified team. You see, while Shaq and Kobe on the LA Lakers were doing the Lone Ranger thing, the Antonio Spurs two towers, David Robinson and Tim Duncan, the two tall men, played to each other's strengths like a well-oiled machine. In other words, the Spurs weren't a group of lone wolves out there, each doing their own thing. That's not who they were. But instead, the Spurs worked as a team. They were swarming around the basketball court, making moves and doing plays left and right so that they swept the Lakers in 4 out of 7 games, all because they used the wisdom of the locusts. They worked as a team. And so it should be with us as believers. Listen, we've got to use the wisdom of locusts and work as a team. You see, listen, if the church is going to learn anything from locusts, we have to discard our Lone Ranger mindsets and begin to understand that if we're ever going to go to the next level as believers, we can't get there by ourselves. In other words, this means that we can't be, it can't be about you singing on the praise team, but it's got to be about us singing on the praise team. It can't be about you ushering about at the doors, but it's got to be about us ushering at the doors and welcoming people in. It can't be about you working in the ministry. It's got to be about us doing ministry. It can't be about you feeding the homeless, but it's got to be about us feeding the homeless. We're always more effective together than we are by ourselves. In other words, I'm better with you than I am without you. Yeah. Listen, if two of you as hungry saints get together in your office and start praying about what's going on the job, the drama, the politics, the abuse, you will turn your workplace upside down. If you and your neighbor start praying about what's going on in your neighborhood, the drugs, the gang violence, the crime, you will turn your neighborhood upside down. If you can touch and agree with anybody in your household about the madness that's going on in there, the conflict, the violence, the anger, you will turn your household upside down. If all the churches in one community would get together and pray and plan and strategize for greater harmony and for greater unity, especially, you know, in this time of polarized division, we would be able to turn our communities upside down. Jesus looked at it and put it like this. He said, if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father who is in heaven. Notice the qualification factor here. Not if a whole lot of folk, but just two or three. Not if a whole army of people, but just two or three. Not if a huge mass of folk, but just two or three. That's all it takes. Just two or three, just two or three folk to pray over a school, just two or three folk to impact a community, all it takes is just two or three folk to open up a business, to start up an organization, to help a teen go to college, two or three folk to help a family get back on its feet, two or three folk to take back a city. Why? Because there's strength in numbers. And hear me when I tell you that when it comes to accomplishing some stuff, we can't be trying to go Lone Ranger on it. In other words, we can't be trying to fly solo. We can't be trying to go it alone, but we have to be willing to work with others and to let others help us. You see, but the problem is that some of us have issues with letting other people into our lives. You don't want to hear this morning. The problem is that some of us have issues letting other people into our lives. We don't want to talk to anybody. We don't want to open up to anybody. We don't want to admit to anybody that we need help or we need something or we're still trying to figure something out. It's just leave me alone and let me be. You stay in your corner and I'll stay in mine. But the locusts teach us that if we're going to accomplish anything worthwhile on this earth, we have to learn to do it together. This means that we've got to put aside our pride, our egos, our self-image, our self-sufficiency, our idiosyncrasies, our Lone Ranger mentalities, and we've got to begin to impact this world for the cause of Christ. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. In other words, we've got to work together. And so the first thing the locusts teach us is that if we're going to accomplish anything of any value or any significance in life, we have to be collaborative people. But then it's interesting to examine another lesson the locust teaches us that's a part of our natural behavior, that's a part of their natural behavior. You see, entomologists tell us that the average large swarm of locusts is able to consume 423 million pounds of plants every day. To put this into perspective, a swarm the size of New York City would eat as much in a day as the populations of New York, New Jersey, and Pennsylvania all combined. In fact, experts say that locust swarms are so ravenous and so voracious in their devouring of crops and agriculture that they will sometimes cause seasons of droughts in certain parts of the globe. And how true this is, because history records that if a swarm of locusts go into a city, once they get in it, all bets are off. They will devour any and everything in sight. They will eat up virtually anything that's growing, all the crops, all the vegetation, all the fruits, weeds, grass, plants, bones, hooves, and all. Just kidding, but you get my point. Nothing green would ever be left in a city when a swarm of locusts come in. By the time the locusts get finished feasting, everything would be bare and dry. In fact, by the time the locusts get finished devouring everything in sight, it would look like the town had been set on fire because all the ground would be a barren brown color. So locusts have a voracious appetite. They are never satisfied. They are never contented. They are never satiated. They're always looking for the next meal. They're always looking for the next hunt. They're always looking for the next kill. Locusts are ravenous creatures. They have a major appetite. In other words, locusts are hungry creatures, and they're always hungry. You see, and that brings us to lesson number two. Listen, the second lesson locusts teach us is that we ought to be hungry people. I think I need to say that again. The second lesson locusts teach us is that we ought to be hungry people. Hungry people. In other words, we ought to have a ravenous appetite for life and the things in life. You see, the problem is that some of us aren't hungry for much of anything. We really don't have much of an appetite. We're not hungry for anything beyond where we are right now. We're not hungry for greater success. We're not hungry for greater fulfillment. We're not hungry for greater accomplishments. We're not hungry for greater anointing. We're not hungry for greater faith, for a deeper spiritual level. We're just not hungry. We're just satisfied and complacent with who we are and where we are. And so while other folk are being driven by their hunger to go for their dreams and their goals, they're just whoosh, passing us by. You know, with advancements on their jobs, they're just whoosh, passing us by. With advancements in their careers, they're just whoosh, passing us by, with change in the enrollment, with rolling back in school and getting their graduate degrees, they're just whoosh, passing us by. With an increase in faith and spirituality, they're just whoosh, passing them by. With growing in how they think and how they learn and how they process and how they become a better people, they're just whoosh, passing us by. But what locusts teach us is that we should be hungry people. That we should have an appetite for something more in life, for more growth, for more development, for more success, for more fulfillment. It's what Jesus was talking about when he says, I have come that ye might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. But in order for us to have an abundant life, we have to be hungry for an abundant life. You're not going to just stumble upon an abundant life. We've got to be hungry. We've got to taste it. We've got to smell it. We've got to go looking for it. We have to have an appetite for the next dimension of what God wants to do in our lives. And the thing I like about the locusts is that they hang out with other locusts. That's the thing we like about them. You never catch a locust, you know, just hanging out with a bee, or you never catch them hanging out with a fly. But the thing about locusts is they only hang out with other locusts. In other words, they only hang out with insects that have a ravenous appetite, just as they have a ravenous appetite. And you see, we have to be people that run with hungry folk. I think I need to say that again. You know, we have to be people that run with other hungry folk, with people who are just like us. See, you can't be running around with some weak, satisfied, complacent, non-vision having people who are not interested in anything in life, who don't want anything, who are not trying to do anything, who are not trying to go anywhere. But we all need to run with some hungry folk. With other people who have an appetite for growth, an appetite for success, an appetite for development, for fulfillment, for more out of life. And can I tell somebody that this would stop a whole lot of jealousy? Can I tell somebody that when you hang out with other folk who have a similar appetite as you, that it stops a whole lot of jealousy? And the reason why is because when you run with some hungry folk, they're so busy eating what God has put in front of them that they don't have time to be thinking about what God has put in front of you. Yeah, we need to run with some hungry folk, with some hungry friends, hungry co-workers, hungry acquaintances, hungry locusts. A few years ago, while watching a program called Caught on Camera on the CNBC network, it featured a story of three very buffoonish and foolish thieves who had broken into a famous fast food restaurant somewhere in the Midwest in the wee hours of the morning. And what was stunning about these buffoons was the fact that they were not covert about their thievery. Instead, they were quite obtrusive and overt about it. Instead of a more clandestine approach, like, you know, climbing through a back window or picking, a lock on the, on a side door or back door, these guys simply took their car, plowed it through the front glass entryway of the restaurant. And if that weren't bad enough, listen to what they did. Unlike most criminals who would make a beeline for the register or for the safe, these criminals did none of that. Instead, they went right to the back freezer. They grabbed some frozen hamburger patties and some frozen French fries, and then proceeded to fry the burgers on the grill and fry the French fries in the deep fry station. And when the cops finally arrived, they couldn't believe what they saw, which was all three of these guys calmly sitting down at one of the dining booths, eating burgers, fries, and sipping on a Coke. And after putting all three of these guys in handcuffs and leading them out, into the squad car, when the cops asked them, why would you break into a restaurant, cook the food, and then sit down and eat it instead of running away? The leader of the group just shrugged his head and said, we were hungry. And this is how you behave when you're hungry in life. You do seemingly stupid things that doesn't make a bit of sense to other people. You see, when you're hungry for a certain job, you keep sending out resumes over and over again to the same company, no matter how many times they reject you. You do seemingly stupid stuff. You see, when you're hungry to start your own business, you keep applying for a business loan over and over and over again, no matter how many banks turn you down. You do seemingly stupid stuff. You see, when you're hungry to be discovered for your talent or for your gift, you keep making crazy videos to grab people's attention and would-be promoters, no matter how crazy it makes you look. You do seemingly stupid stuff. When you're hungry to fulfill your dreams and your aspirations, you'll do everything from sell your car to your house in order to get your dream back on the road so that you can make your career happen, that you'll do seemingly stupid stuff, because that's what happens when you're really hungry. Your appetite for success is so big that you don't care. You don't care what you gotta do. You don't care what it costs you. You don't care how crazy you look. You don't care what people say about you. You don't care what you gotta give up. You don't care what the whispers are. You used to care. You used to think about what other people thought about you. But because now that you're hungry, now that you lived a while, now that you've gone through some stuff, now that you've missed some opportunities, you couldn't give a rat's tail how stupid you look, because your stomach is grumbling, your lips are smacking, your taste buds are craving, your nostrils are smelling the success for something better in life, for something bigger in life, for something that will fulfill you, that will gratify you, that will indulge your purpose, that will indulge your passion. Oh, I wonder where the hungry locusts are today. Folk who have an appetite for something greater in life, for something bigger in life, better in life, more fulfilling in life, more gratifying in life. For folk who have an appetite to go to the next level of your journey. Oh, where are the hungry folk? Paul looked at it and put it like this. He says, I press toward the mark. Notice he says pressing, because pressing indicates that there's pressure coming from the other end. He says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. He's talking about being a hungry locust. So the first thing that Paul, the first lesson Paul wants us to give us about these locusts is that we have to be collaborative. If we're going to be, the first lesson locusts teach us is that we have to be collaborative people. And then the second lesson locusts teach us is that we have to be hungry people. But lastly, it's compelling to investigate a final lesson the locusts teaches us, and it's simply this. Entomologists, scientists who study insects tell us that when locusts would try to come to a city and the people would catch wind that they're on the way, the people would try to do everything under the sun to stop them from entering the city, but it was often to no avail. They could not keep locusts out. If they built a wall, the locusts would just fly over it. If they didn't fly over the wall, they would just squeeze through the cracks. If they sprayed chemicals, the locusts would just develop an immunity to it. Whatever they did, it was to no avail because the locusts would just keep coming. Because locusts are tenacious. They're unstoppable. They never quit. In other words, locusts are relentless animals. Their mentality is that once I have my eyes fixed on some vegetation, once we as a group have our eyes fixed on some fruits, some trees, some plants, some vegetables, nothing is going to stop us from getting it. In other words, no one, once locusts get started, no one can ever stop them because they are relentless. You see, and that brings us to lesson number three. You see, the third thing the locusts teach us is that we should be relentless people. I think I need to say that again. The third thing the locusts teach us is that we should be relentless people. You know what it means to be relentless. It means that we have to be the kind of people who are tenacious, who are unstoppable. Relentless means that we've got to be the kind of people who never give up, who never stop trying, who never quit. And you see, I am convinced that one of the main reasons some of us are unhappy with our lives is because at some earlier point in our journey, we simply gave up. We gave up on stuff in life that would have launched us into the next level or to the next dimension that God has for us. We gave up on our education, on our goals, on our dreams, on our relationships, on ever having anything better in life. We gave up on what we were passionate about. We gave up. And as a result, we've had to settle for a lackluster, mediocre existence with no hope of anything greater. But the locusts teach us of the value of being relentless, relentless in our pursuit of what God has for us, relentless in our goals, in our dreams, relentless in our objectives, in our life's vision, relentless in going to the next level, relentless in becoming our best selves. In other words, no matter how bad the obstacles are, don't quit. Oh, if you're sitting next to somebody this morning, just look at them and say, don't quit, especially you, if you know they're going for some stuff. Yeah, I know the obstacles are getting harder, but don't quit. I know doors keep shutting. I understand that, but don't quit. I know the opportunities are bleak right now, but don't quit. I know that you're tired of getting the rejection notices, but don't quit. I know nothing seems to be panning out for you, but don't quit. I understand that. I know that the harder you pray, the more doors shut in your face, but don't quit. Listen, in his book, Success Principles, author Jack Canfield talks about a technique that he and his partners used to stay relentless when they were trying to get their book, which everybody knows about, Chicken Soup for the Soul, published. He writes this, that he was told when they were trying to get Chicken Soup for the Soul published, he writes this. He says, that he was told that the title of their book was just not captivating enough and that it would never work. And then he writes, quote, that after being rejected by more than 30 publishers, our agent finally gave us back the book and said, I'm sorry, but I just can't sell it for you. There's nothing I can do. Nobody wants it. Then he writes, he says, what did we do when our agent just gave it back to us and told us that he gave up? He says, we just looked at each other and we just said, next. He said, instead of getting depressed, instead of getting down, instead of giving up, he says, they just looked at each other and said, next. And they went on to the next publisher. And this is what some of us are going to have to do to stay relentless. We're just going to have to simply say next and move on to the next prospect. Yeah, so if one job turns you down, just say next and move on to the next job. If one door shuts in your face, just say next and move on to the next door. If one career doesn't work, just say next and move on to the next one. If one man doesn't treat you right, just say next and move on to the next man. If one woman doesn't treat you well, she starts getting deeper on you, just say next and go on to the next woman. Because somewhere, somewhere somebody wants what you have to offer. I think I need to say that again, because somewhere somebody wants what you have to offer. Yeah, because somewhere somebody wants your gifts, your talents, your abilities, your charisma, your personality, your passion, what you have going for you, your skill set. Somebody wants your unique set of abilities. And if it weren't so, God wouldn't have given it to you. In other words, we have to take a page out of the Locusts book. If you can't get through the front door, then go through the window. If you can't go through the window, then climb up through the chimney. If you can't climb up through the chimney, then come up under the porch. If you can't come up under the porch, then squeeze through the vent. If you can't squeeze through the exhaust vent, then crawl through a drainage pipe. But whatever you do, don't. Because oftentimes, just before we're, you don't hear me. Because oftentimes, just before you quit, is when you're at the cusp, is when you're at the tip of your promised land, is when you're at the gate of your opportunity. Oh, I wonder if there are any relentless locusts listening today. Where are the relentless locusts today? Where are the come or hell, high water folk? Where are the no holds barred folk this morning? Where are the I won't stop folk? Where are the I won't be defeated folk? Where are the I'll never give up folk? The I'll never surrender folk? The I'll never throw in the towel folk? The I'll never wave a white flag folk? Oh, I may not look like much, but I'm relentless. I may not have much, but I'm relentless. I may be broke, but I'm relentless. I may be sick, but I'm relentless. I may be divorced, but I'm relentless. I may be bankrupt, but I'm relentless. I may be brokenhearted, but I'm relentless. I may be depressed, but I'm relentless. I may be down, but I'm relentless. I may be struggling, but I'm relentless. I may be going through, but I'm relentless. Where are the relentless locusts today? So the locusts have taught us three lessons. The first lesson the locusts have taught us is that we ought to be collaborative people. And then the second thing that the locusts have taught us is that we ought to be hungry people. And then the third thing the locusts have taught us is that we have to be relentless people. But as I get ready to wrap up this word today, there's just one more thing I've got to deposit in your spirit before we leave you. And it's simply this. Listen, what's interesting to note about locusts is that locusts can actually fly many miles, many miles. In fact, in spite of their little wings, locusts can fly across continents. It's unbelievable. But the irony is that they, in and of themselves, aren't great flyers. That's the irony. Actually, instead of being great flyers, locusts are great jumpers who are able to jump 2.3 feet in the air, which is equivalent to us as human beings jumping 60 feet in the air, relatively speaking. But what really enables them to fly is not their great wings, their very small wings. What really enables them to fly is the wind. The wind. You see, when the wind is blowing, all the locusts need to do is jump up, and the wind then carries it along. Because locusts weigh only about 2 grams, they're light enough for the wind to just carry along. And this is what enables them to fly. And so it is with us. You see, in the life of the believer, Wind symbolizes the Holy Spirit. You know where I'm going with this. And when we discern the presence of the Holy Spirit in a situation, all we need to do is jump, take a leap of faith, and he'll take us places we could never go on our own. He'll take us through doors, through this door and that door. He'll take us through this opportunity and that opportunity. He'll take us through this accomplishment and that accomplishment. He'll take us through this level and that new level. He'll take us through this job and that new job. He'll take us through this achievement and that achievement. In other words, when you feel the movement, you don't hear me, when you feel the power, the rush of the Holy Spirit in a situation in your life, that's when all you have to do is jump and he'll take you the rest of the way. It's what the prophet Zechariah was talking about when he says, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. If we'll just jump, if you're sitting next to somebody, just tell them jump. He'll carry us through the sky of life to achieve things we could never achieve on our own. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. Eagles, run and not be weary, walk and not faint. And by the way, stay with me now. When the swarm of locusts are being carried by the wind, they don't get to decide their direction. They don't get to decide their destiny when they're being carried by the wind. The wind just takes them where it will go. And so it is with us, just as a caveat this morning, that when we're being carried by the Holy Spirit, we don't get to decide. I know this bothers us, but we don't get to decide our destiny. We don't always get to decide where we would like to go. But the Holy Spirit will take us where he intends for us to go. If he wants us to go east, we're going east. If he wants us to go west, we're going west. If he wants us to go north, we're going north. If he wants us to go south, we're going south. But rest assured that wherever he takes us, no matter where it is, it's always the best place to be, because the safest place to be is in the will of God, where we can grow, where we can develop, where we can make a difference, where we can affect change, where we can reach our potential, where we can become our best selves, because that's the life of a locust. Where he leads, I shall follow. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delights in his way. Now you think on these things. Well, that's it, my brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ. Hopefully that word this morning gave you some encouragement. Hopefully it challenged you. It gave you something to think about. Hopefully if someone was on the brink of giving up and just throwing in the towel and just whatever, hopefully this has resuscitated you and reinvigorated you to get back in the game and to be like the locusts who are relentless and let the Holy Spirit just carry you where he would have you to go. But if you're here this morning and you've heard this word and you have found it to be encouraging, but you don't know the God of the word, I now take this time to offer Christ to you. Romans 10 and 9 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Revelation 3:20, Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. John 6:37 says, him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. If you're here this morning or you catch this later on in the week and you're not saved, but you want to be, I offer Christ to you. We offer Christ to you this morning. And if you want to be saved, which means that you have renounced your old life and embarked upon a new life with Christ, which has an end point of heaven, if that's you and you want to be saved, all you have to do is repeat the words of a prayer that I'm getting ready to pray. And if you mean them truly in your heart, the Bible declares that you will be saved. So with that in mind, if you're not saved, but you want to be, repeat these words after me. Lord, I thank you for sending Jesus Christ to die for my sins. Lord, I admit that I am a sinner and that I need you. Please forgive me of my sins. And Lord, I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe he died for my sins. I believe he was buried. And I believe he rose from the grave. And Lord, I ask Jesus Christ to come into my heart, to be my Lord and my Savior. And Lord, I do now confess Jesus Christ as my Lord and my Savior. And I ask you into my heart to walk with me, to talk with me, to lead me throughout the rest of my life so that I might live a life satisfying to you. And now, Lord, based upon the profession of my faith, save me now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, my brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ, if you prayed that prayer and you believed it in your heart, the Bible declares that you are saved. Romans 10:13 says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Amen. With that in mind, before we leave this live stream sermon session, we do want to remind you that if you're giving online gifts today, you have up until 11:59 p.m. to give your gifts. So please keep that in mind. Also want to remind you to come Zoom with us on Wednesday evenings at 7:30. And you're sure to find something to be a blessing to you. And in our Bible studies, I'm sure there's something that will tug upon your heart and that will enlighten you in some area. So that's our Zoom Bible studies, Wednesday, 7:30 p.m. You can find the link on both our website and our Facebook page. Also, we do want to let you know, remind you that Maximize Giving Sunday is moving towards us. It is, remember, the last Sunday of this month, the fifth Sunday, November 29th, Maximize Giving Sunday, November 29th. And so we do want to remind you to please do not forget, if you have not already begun, to budget out for that event, if you would do so, because that's what it's going to take. Because we are up against the holiday season, and that always makes it a sort of operose task. To raise the money in November. But we're well able, as Caleb 12 told the 10 spies. And so we do want to remind you that to please start budgeting. We need 50 people at the 400 level, 50 people at the 300 level, and 50 people at the 200 level. If we can get that, we will have way more than enough than what we need in order to reach our goal. So please be mindful of that. Again, that's the last Sunday of this month. Also, we do want to encourage you in the aftermath of what has been a very partisan and polarizing election. We do solicit your prayers for President-elect Biden. We want to be praying for him even before he takes office. I think we all know that he will be faced with a tall order, or is faced with a tall order. And so we want to encourage you just to be praying for him and to lift him up so that the Lord just gets him prepared for all that he has to deal with us in these turbulent times. And we also want to encourage you to pray for peace and pray for unity. I think our country is so polarized. And there's so much partisan tension and populist tension at that, that we just need peace. And so pray for peace. Isaiah 56:3 says, thou shalt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. So I want to encourage you to please pray for peace in our country so that the transition coming up in a few months will be smooth and that we can move forward and begin to get back to being a normal functioning democracy. Amen. So please keep that in mind. Also, we do want to also remind you to continue watching. You can go to our Facebook page for our weekly video updates, and the weekly video updates, we do share a more detailed announcements than I would do in a live stream session such as today. So if you want weekly updates, you can go to our Facebook page, and there's always an announcements screen where I'm doing weekly video announcements. So you can always check there. So we also do want to encourage you that as we are in the midst of COVID-19 and as the numbers are rising in the entire country, with the exception of one state, I think, please be careful. Please wear your mask. Please don't congregate. I know that we're getting ready to embark upon the holiday seasons, but we implore you to be as judicious and wise and cautious as possible, and to make sure that you're wearing your mask and doing all that we can so that we can be safe, and that so that no one else has to be fall victim to this virus. Well, join me, if you will, in this closing prayer as we ask blessings upon us as the people. We're also going to see you on Wednesday afternoon. Gracious and almighty God, we thank you and we praise you for the word that was shared this afternoon, this morning. We thank you, God, for the fellowship via this live stream sermon session. We thank you, God, for your faithfulness to us, both corporately and individually, despite all that is going on in our country and in our communities. We thank you for your goodness, your grace, and your mercy. And now, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things, and the God of peace shall be with you. In the precious and in the holy name of Jesus, we do pray. And all of God's people said amen and amen and amen. We want to thank you for coming to the Total Life Church YouTube channel, where through the Lord Jesus Christ, we live life totally. God bless you, saints of God. We'll see you next week. Same place, same time, same TLC style of communing on our YouTube channel. Have a blessed week in the Lord, and go change your, you got it, world. See you soon.